Hello, everybody. Hello, hello. Sorry it took a little bit longer to get live and thing. I'm very, very happy that we have a good group of people waiting for all of us to be here. Hello, everybody. It's very, very nice to see you all. Allow me to introduce our authors before we get properly, or the bookstore, sorry, before we get properly into introducing our authors. So, welcome back to Book Passages Conversations with Authors series. If you've seen one of these events before, well, then we're very, very glad to see you here one more time. And if you're new here, then Book Passage is a group of independently run bookstores out of the San Francisco Bay Area. And we host and run book talks just like these very often throughout the week, both in person and online. As we are streaming on YouTube, and we'll continue to do so in the future, please consider subscribing by clicking the subscribe button just below the video. It's completely free to you, and it helps us out a lot. It helps us get our book talks into as many people as possible. And additionally, as like an added bonus, if you click the little bell just next to the subscribe button, you'll be alerted every single time that we go live. You might find a conversation that you otherwise would have missed out on that you really enjoy. If you'd like to check out our upcoming events or just like the idea of an email newsletter, you can find both of those at bookpassage.com. And additionally, if you'd like to check out our book tonight, which is Jane of Hearts and Other Stories or anything else by our In Conversation author, or anything that happens to be mentioned here tonight, you can find all of those at bookpassage.com as well, or using the first link in the description below. Finally, and this one's quite important, if you have any questions for either of our speakers tonight, please take the time to write them in the YouTube chat. It's the only way to get your questions to the speakers, and I don't want you to miss out on your chance because you're waiting for anything else. Please just take the time to write them in the YouTube chat. Now, allow me to introduce Katharine Weber, who's the author of six acclaimed novels, which is Still Life with Monkey, True Confections, Triangle, Little Women, the musical. I wrote True Confessions, and I was very confused. I'm
Yeah.
like, that's not the book. That's not the book. Sorry, the music lesson, Objects in the Mirror Are Closer Than They Appear, and a memoir, The Memory of All That, George Gershwin, K. Swift, and My Family's Legacy of Infidelities. Weber lives in Connecticut. In conversation tonight, we have Meg Waite Clayton, who is seems to be a fixture of Book Passage. I've seen her go by many, many, many times in upcoming events that will happen in the coming months as well. But nonetheless, Meg Waite Clayton is the New York Times bestselling author of eight novels, including The Postmistress of Paris, which I've read personally. I think is quite good. She's also the National Jewish Book Award finalist and international bestseller for The Last Train of London, the Lagnum Award honoree for The Race to Paris, Bellwether Prize finalist for The Language of Night and The Wednesday Sisters, and Entertainment Weekly 25 Essential Best Friend Novels of All Time. Novels have been published in 32 or 23 different languages, written more than 100 essays, opinions, and reviews for major newspapers, magazines, and public radios. She mentors the Op-Ed Project and is a member of the National Book Critics Circle and the California Bar. We are very, very lucky to have both of them here with us tonight. Please join me welcoming Katharine Weber and Meg Wakeling. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank
I
you.
mean, I'm just grateful, Meg, that you're here. It means something different to a writer when a fellow writer, sponsors a conversation like this, and it really, it's a different kind of engagement, and I really appreciate it.
It is. I'm going to start by telling the audience that Catherine is so generous that almost 20 years ago now, 20 years ago now, she blurred my very first novel, my debut novel. We'd met on a forum called Readerville, and she was just lovely and generous and has always been. And I am so grateful for her friendship over the years. As you can tell, I am a fan. These are all signed first editions of her novels. I
And they're
have her.
always there right behind you at all times,
No, but you know what?
right?
15 minutes ago, I knew exactly where they were so I could pull them out. So, and the only thing I don't have is the memoir, which goes on a different shelf and it's in a different room. And so I haven't dug it out. But so I want to start by saying, showing this beautiful book again, Jane of Hearts and Other Stories, which I had the privilege to read and absolutely thought it was wonderful. And I am so thrilled to talk to you about it, Catherine. And I thought maybe we'd start, if it's all right with you, just to give everybody hear a little feel for the sound of the book, although obviously these are all different stories and they're a little different. But if I could ask you to read just the very opening of the title story and
the novella, Jane of Hearts. Novella,
exactly, yes. Jane of Hearts.
Okay. So I've never read this to anybody before, saying, okay.
And right. She had no warning because I just
and I had no warning. And I want to say that there is a little epigraph that I think has tremendous meaning for this novella, which is, it is a joy to be hidden, but a disaster not to be found. D.W. Winnicott. Their crimes were crimeless, or nearly so. Nobody was home when they broke in and rambled around those houses on Jane's Street. They never caused any damage or left any trace of their expeditions. An unlocked window or sliding door, a key under the mat or under a flower pot on the back steps. There was always a perfectly easy way for two children to slip unnoticed inside the unoccupied houses in this neighborhood.
So I have to say, I love that opening. I loved every story in this collection, but I especially love that opening. The evocation of just this, childhood that seemed very reminiscent of my childhood and so very real to me. I will tell the audience without wanting to spoil anything, but this is a story kind of on the surface about a couple of childhood, not even friends, they meet one summer when they are the
allies.
Only kids left in the neighborhood.
Yes.
And they go into houses and explore, go into empty houses and explore. And I thought it was just so charming and wonderful and revealing of so much. And I wondered if you'd start by telling us if you are a Jane or a Tate, and if you are one or the other, if you had the other as a friend when you were a child.
No, I didn't have anyone that I bossed around and considered to be my perfect assistant, the way the dynamic works with these two. But I think I certainly had those lonely moments of feeling that other families were having lives that I wasn't having, and envy, and a kind of envy mixed with the contempt that my family felt for other families, but sort of nose to the glass. And once, I did go into a neighbor's house because I knew where they had the key. And at another time I had been asked to, I forget what, feed a cat or something. And I simply went in and wandered around and left, my heart hammering the whole time, convinced, you know, I probably would never be allowed to, you know, be in society after that. But I have to say, I was very, very interested when I heard an interview with Katharine Hepburn long ago, where she talked about when she was a kid, maybe young teenager, roaming around and breaking into houses in her neighborhood in Bloomfield, Connecticut, and how she actually did that a lot and was never caught. And that just has always stuck with me.
So was that the jumping off point? That was where the story began with Katharine Hepburn, what she did?
One of the places, I have to say, without sounding so pretentious, no one would possibly want to read this. I think it has a subtle relationship to Turn of the Screw. I think it has a relationship that's not even subtle to me, to the great book of my childhood, Harriet the Spy. Yes. So part of it isn't just, you know, breaking into people's houses and taking little souvenirs. And in fact, the cover of the book is a very literal representation of the souvenirs they take and collect. But surveilling the notebook, the making notes about people, reporting on people, keeping an eye on people. And that, to me, rang very true emotionally when I read Harriet the Spy long ago. And I know a lot of writers where it's one of their favorite books, I have to say. Favorite childhood.
I was going to say, I love that book. My sons love that. I actually don't know if, I don't remember if I read Harriet the Spy when I was young, but my son read it when he was young, and I read it with him, and I became such a great fan that, you know, there's a new audio book of it that was out maybe a year or two ago, and I've recently listened to the audio and remembered what it's about, so that's lovely. It absolutely evokes for me Harriet the Spy. I'm going to say that it didn't occur to me when I was reading it, but when you say that, I think, oh yeah, that's totally it.
And the relationship between Harriet and the boy.
Yes.
I mean, there is, it is that sort of duo. And that was not an accident for me wanting to.
Oh, interesting. So this, you know, the boy's name is Tate. And, you know, one of the things I love about what you do throughout this collection is you are so astute at what I call efficient characterization. So these characters in all these stories, they come to life so quickly and so beautifully. And so, you know, Tate's a young boy. I think I can say this much without spoiling anything about the story. He's a young boy who is spending the summer in the neighborhood with his grandmother because of some things that are going on with his parents, which are not what you would expect. They're not, you know, the typical divorced or whatever. And he wears an eye patch. And because he wears an eye patch, when he bikes, he has no depth perception. And so he's limited to, he's only supposed to bike around the block. And so it's in his biking around the block that he and Jane connect. And I'm curious to know how he came to you as a character. So obviously there was some Harriet the Spy connection there, but he's his own character. So how do you do that? How do you make him his own character?
You know, this could sound like a strange answer, strange way in. For a long while, I had in mind that this novella had a title that it doesn't have entirely now, which was Jane of Hearts, One-Eyed Jack, and the Suicide King. And card players know that there is no Jane of Hearts, even though I made one and it's on the cover of the book. And One-Eyed Jacks, there are two One-Eyed Jacks in the deck because they're in profile, and sometimes in poker, One-Eyed Jacks are wild, you know. And the Suicide King, is it the King of Hearts, the King of Spades? He's got a sword that looks as if it's going through his head. So it's just slang for those cards. But that was the title in my mind for a long, long while. And it involved these children playing a very, very serious card game they make up and where they identify with the cards. And I think that's still there, but it certainly is no longer the center of gravity for the novella. But right. Don't you find that what might be the grain of sand that grows the pearl then becomes adjacent to some other main event in a novel you're writing?
Totally, I do. I think, you know, I think when people ask me how I start writing, I always say, you know, any way I can. And it's often a small thing that sends me going that even sometimes disappears entirely by the time that novel or that story is done, but it got me going, so.
Right, a situation, and then a question of, well, who would be in that situation? And then what would happen, and then what? And it may really get moved from the center way off to the side, you know, before you're done. Right. If you're paying attention to what you're writing and not just dragging people through your original outline from plot point to plot point, which if you succeed in doing that all the way to the end, then you know you have failed.
I think that's true. I think, let's ask, so this is about you. Do you find that your writing surprises you, and do you like that or dislike that?
Oh, I think it's essential. It's essential. You have to be willing to be surprised. So I'm a big believer in making plans and then deviating from the plans. I do think it's good to have a plan, but I also think that if you don't surprise yourself, then you're not really fully tuned in. What fiction writer do you know who wouldn't want to be surprised?
Right, exactly. And if you're not surprised as a writer, it's hard to say that, you know, the reader's going to be surprised. So, So let me ask specifically about Jane of Hearts. I mean, I know a lot of these stories were, and we'll talk about a couple of the other ones, but a lot of these stories were published elsewhere and then collected here over a long period of time.
Yes, my first story in print is here, Friend of the Family, which became a part of my first
and that's
novel.
The one that was published in the New Yorker.
Correct. And it was my first fiction in print.
Okay, I don't like you anymore.
Well, I'm not sure if that's gonna happen again anytime soon, but it was my debut as a fiction writer in print. I was working as a critic and a journalist, but it was my first fiction in print, which was taken off the slush pile by Dan Menaker.
That's amazing.
So that appeared in 1993. But there are, that has only a few emendations, but some of the stories really were in embryonic form in their first publication and have expanded and changed and really been sort of transmuted by the context of this collection. And in some cases, I just realized I had so much more to say. And I also saw the connections, because it turns out from the time I began publishing fiction, in some way, it's all one, this is going to sound nuts, one organism. You know, isn't there some horrifying fungus that turns out to be, you know, 20 miles across underground or something, and it's all one thing? You know, and I just feel as if it turns out that everything I've ever written is part of some the body of work in a very almost literal sense, where it flows together, it fits together. I'm a better writer now than I was when I published some of the earliest stories, but I just had, there was so much more to say and do, and it was like being able to re-enter a dream, go back to sleep and dream that dream some more. I mean, and I realize lots of writers would just never look back, just wouldn't do that. But there are precedents. John Barth revised The Floating Opera. Henry James revised stories and novellas late in life. I don't mean to compare myself to Henry James. I'm just saying it's a habit that it's not uniquely mine. And I justify it.
Not at all. A true story. What I, for my first reading of my first novel, a good friend, Ellen Sessman, who we both know, emailed me the next day, and she said, "I think I have your reading copy of your book. I think they sold me your reading copy of
your notes in it." Right.
And I said, "I said, how do you know it's mine?" She said, "Well, I've lived 2 years, or somebody else is editing the section that you read." I was already, editing it before I even finished reading it. Right. I think there are sort of two kinds of writers: people who don't ever look back and don't ever, once it's in print, they're done. And then there sounds like you and me, that we're always thinking about what we're doing, even the stuff that's already done, and sort of how it might be something different. So,
and it was a tremendous opportunity to sort of if I were a painter, it would turn out that something I had painted long ago turns out to be a pendant piece for some larger work.
So let's focus on that underlying fungus for a minute. So, I think
so attractive sounding.
I think it's something that that writers, it's hard to imagine as you're looking forward early on in your career, that your writing is connected in some way. As you start to get, we'll call it a body of work, right? You have a body of work now, and you can see the threads that go through, the fungus that underlies it all.
Yes.
So, what do you talk about what you think that is?
Well, for instance, with this book, the very first story, Mr. Antler's Princess Dust, the first sentence is, "The summer they tried going door to door selling poison mushrooms. Two children, once again, sort of on the edge of danger that they're not very aware of." And it begins with that, and it ends with something also dangerous that they're not really aware of. And it sort of bookends, with Jane of Hearts. And then somewhere in the middle, we have a story that's maybe a bit of an outlier, because it's about two teenagers, near adults, who climbed to the very top of the World Trade Center when it was still under construction, which is also a pair having an adventure or a misadventure without full awareness of just how incredibly crazy and dangerous it is. And that actually has an unusual origin, because I wrote it originally as an essay for Ellen Sussman's collection. My publisher, Paul Dry, loves that essay, and asked me to do something, which at first I just thought, no, he doesn't understand where fiction comes from, because he wanted me to recast it as a work of fiction. It's like, no, that's not what it is. That's not what it was. But I realized that it was a really intriguing challenge. And in fact, I think it does work as a work of fiction. And there's a lot that I took liberties with, because it's fiction. Even essays, of course, you always are taking liberties. I don't mean you're lying exactly, but you're making choices about what you tell and how you tell it and what you don't tell and how you don't tell that. But this is a work of fiction that had its origins in personal experience, like no other work of fiction I have ever written.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. That's cool.
And there it is in the middle of the book. And it's the same story of two people egging each other on to do a dangerous thing without full awareness that it's possibly life-threatening, you know, so.
Sorry, that's my phone ringing in the background. In all the excitement getting this Zoom started, I forgot to turn off my phone and put on my do not disturb. So,
no worries.
Yeah, let's see. I'm gonna focus on.
And I should say, Jane and Tate, in addition to breaking into houses, as you know, at a certain point they discover a, if not abandoned, certainly neglected, forgotten, bomb shelter, fully stocked, and they make that their headquarters. And adults might not think that's going to end well.
all these stories, I mean, a lot of these stories anyway, I don't want to say all of them, but there's a lot of, like, you're just talking about the opening story, Mr. Antler's Princess Dust, and a lot of these have a thread, a real tension running through the story, which really carries the reader, because you're not sure what's going to happen, and you do feel these often kids are in some sort of peril. Is that something you like to do, and do you do it consciously, or does it just happen?
I think in this collection, I think it's very organized in that way, although there are also a couple of stories, there are some stories that are about just adults, and then there are a couple of stories about old ladies, you know, sort of at the other end of life. I always like the way a certain kind of narrative gives the reader an experience as they read of building almost a counter narrative. So the reader starts to see things and know things that the characters don't. And even if the character thinks he or she is in charge and knows what's going on and is trying to direct the information of the story, the reader is still building a counter narrative, and starts to conclude different things about what's happening and what it means and what might happen next.
Right, right. And then the other thing that I thought really was really interesting and beautifully done in Mr. Antler's Princess is you have this dynamic of these two friends, and one of them has a younger sibling. And they are quite cruel to the younger sibling, I'm just going to say.
She sort of follows them around and they're mean to her. Yes.
She eats ants. She eats, you know, just all sorts of things. And she takes it. She takes it. The young girl takes it and, you know, for she just takes it. And so I'm going to ask if you were an older sibling or a younger sibling. And
I'm a younger. My mother was one of three sisters. She was the middle, and that always has fascinated me. And I've written about three sisters in The Little Women. I lived next door to a family of three girls and a boy. I lived across the street from a family of three girls. And then next door to them was a family of 16 children, and they really fascinated me, the Cougar. I grew up in a neighborhood that was full of sort of baby, you know, first wave baby boom children playing in the street, you know, the sort of classic idyllic when the street lights go on, maybe you should go home. And you know, playing in people's backyards or playing in people's garages, getting locked into people's garages, you know, feeling as if everything is always at the edge of peril, as if everything is a secret mission. So I think it's got endless possibilities for giving the reader that awareness, that uneasiness that the characters might not possess, actually.
Yeah. So I'm just going to invite everybody again to throw questions in the, I guess it's in the YouTube chat, and they'll be tossed out to us to talk about, and we're here to talk about anything you would like to talk about. I'd love to talk about the differences in, I mean, so we've got, Jane, which is a novella. It's, I don't know, 40 or 50 pages, I guess. And then you have something as short as Diamond District, which is literally, you know, a page and a half.
A classic flash story.
Do you, and then obviously you've written many novels and memoirs, right? So do you have a comfort zone in terms of what you're writing, or do you enjoy, like, do you prefer writing novels? Do you prefer writing stories?
I think I'm a novelist. But I loved writing the novella. You know, I most recently taught for several years at Kenyon College, and several times I taught a course I invented called Reading and Writing the Novella. And it made me really want to write a novella. Although my second novel, The Music Lesson, is almost a novella, the way Gatsby is probably a novella for by many measures. I don't mean to say it's like Gatsby. I just mean it's something that's published as a novel, but by many measures, it's a novella. I wanted to pursue that form very specifically, partly because of one of the discoveries I made with my students teaching reading and writing the novella, which is that aside from some of the obvious things about, you know, what is a novella, it's not just a long story or a short novel. It has its own kind of sort of single narrative. It often takes place just in sort of connected time from here to there, has far fewer side stories, backstories. You know, it's got a sort of single purpose. If you think of Goodbye Columbus, it's that summer. You know, you think of Sonny's Blues, you think of, you know, I mean, all the things we read in that course. And one of the things that bound everything, the aspirin papers, obsession. A good novella, a classic timeless novella we're still talking about, has an obsession at its heart. And I did not know that until we discovered it. So it seems to me that it's an essential ingredient. If you're writing a novella, what's at stake? How do you make it more at stake? For whom is it the obsession? What's at stake here? What matters most? And I think, I don't mean you have to artificially sort of cook it up. I mean, I think it has to belong there, but it is one of the organizing principles, I think, of a novella.
How interesting. I've never written a novella. I've never tried to write a novella, but I have read many of them, including, you know, for example, Sonny's Blues, which I think was called a short story when I read it, but it really is.
It is a novella.
It's a novella. Yeah, I said to one of my friends at the time, I love, because when I first started writing, I struggled with short stories, and I said, but I loved Sonny's Blues. And a teacher friend of mine said, of course you do. It's a novel in a few pages, you know, so.
Right. So. And, you know, I think one of the reasons the short story form is what is used is a teaching and whether it's undergrads or MFA programs, is simply it's a manageable length to read and discuss and workshop and revise in the course of a semester. I think having taught in MFA programs, I do think that people are not necessarily prepared to write the novel and revise the novel, having had a steady diet of short stories. And the requirements are different, the feelings are different, it's the language is different, the pace is different. It's not the same thing.
It's so very different. I do think you can learn a lot of, you know, kind of on a prose level by doing the short story and about the arc of narrative and that kind of thing.
But and how to write sentences, absolutely.
Yeah, right.
And you know,
right.
When Friend of the Family appeared in the New Yorker, I had a glorious editing experience with Dan Menaker, which I think I took in from then to now as, you know, the psychoanalytic term would be an introject, you know, the voice. I think that what I learned editing the story with him applied to the novel, which I then finished, and it was then my first novel that was published. And I think from then to now, some of what went on in the editing was just incredibly formative for me. And it's subtle. It's not as if, I mean, if you saw what I submitted to the New Yorker, you would recognize it. It's the same story. But he would say, well, okay, this isn't a very interesting adjective. You can do better, you know, think about it. You know, just, there were just places to, make opportunities, I would say. And I think the inexperienced writer makes the least of opportunities. And I think the more experience you have, the more you recognize them when they're there.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think, you know, some people seem to think that you can't teach anything about writing, but I actually think that you can teach a lot about writing. And it's just in that kind of thing, in enhancing your awareness of what there is and what works and what doesn't and that kind of thing.
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, I don't think you can teach talent to someone with no talent, but I think you can teach craft. I think just about anybody is a better writer at the end of the semester than the beginning of the semester if the teaching is good and they're really engaged.
Well, so talk about brilliance in writing. I think, you know, part of the reason I wanted you to read that first, the opening of Jane of Hearts, is that it's just so beautifully done. The prose is so beautiful. The The variation in the sentences is gorgeous. You know, you have a couple of really short sentences, you know, a sentence fragment, and then a long sentence at the end, and it's all, you know, the adjectives are all, the details are all so exquisite. And so that in those just few lines, this story pops to life really gorgeously. I know a lot of
you're saying that, you know, that first sentence was in my head for a long while for this, which is putting something on the table and then immediately taking it off again. Their crimes were crimeless.
Yeah, exactly. that's such a nice contrast, and that kind of contrast makes you think, ooh, why is that? You know, it just piques your curiosity. So it's really beautifully done. I said, actually, you can see my thing. When I read it at first, I underlined all the opening stuff, and then I wrote in the margin, great opening line. And that's bad. Yes, I meant those two, their crimes were crimeless. That's a great.
I'm a huge believer in the significance of beginnings and endings. I would teach a masterclass on beginnings and endings. I mean, I really do think they matter hugely. I don't just mean the information. I mean, the pace, the language, the relationship to the rest of the piece. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And I'm not going to read the end of Chain of Hearts because I don't want to give anything away, but especially for this one because it's a longer story. But I think that in all these stories, you start someplace and then you sort of circle back to someplace in a way that's really effective. And there you can see the reader looking back can see the connection between your closing and your opening in a way that makes the opening all the more impressive because it's in some ways tells the reader where they're going, which you realize after you've read it, oh, that's where we're going. I see now. So it's kind of like that. And there's a lot of kind of inevitable surprises here. For example, in Mr. Antler's Princess Dust, the ending there is the kind of almost like the definition of inevitable surprise in many ways. It's just really, really nicely done. So
thank you. There are echoes from one story to the next in some ways. So the ending of Party Animals has a very similar moment with something glittery being thrown in the air. And also the reader has all kinds of forebodings that the characters in that moment do not have. So I wanted there to be those echoes, like a melody, a sequence of notes, you know, that you hear here and then you hear it there. Most of the stories have a relationship to Northbury, Connecticut, which is a town that doesn't quite exist. And diamonds also figure in every story, one way or another.
Interesting.
In small ways or in large ways, but diamonds are everywhere.
Yeah, how interesting. And indeed, oh no, hearts on the cover. I was thinking that maybe there'd be a diamond card on the cover.
There are three diamonds right over the H.
Oh, all right.
Over the H of hearts. There, you see them? They're there.
Oh yeah, totally.
Marbles, buttons, and a green M&M. Yes.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful.
The green M&M being a reference to sleeping, the other flash story that's here.
So you obviously had some input in the cover.
More than input. And in fact, that's my stuff. I mean, I worked with the marvelous designer who was very patient with me. And in fact, the very last thing was on the back of the book. If you turn it over and look at the bottom, there are poison mushrooms that connect to the very first sentence of the book.
Yeah.
So, I mean, everything you see signifies in the stories. And then again, I mean, there is recapitulation of objects in the stories. And then again, in the novella, you meet some of the same objects again.
Yeah, that might be everybody who's here may not realize, but the cover, it's obviously so important to a book. It's, you know, what makes you want to pick it up first. And yet very often authors have no input whatsoever on the covers. It's considered a marketing decision. And even those of us who get consulting rights or whatever, you have to be in pretty rare air to get cover approval. You know, that's
I have always had a lot of input, and I often have sort of undercut the problem by owning it. Hello, it's me, the novelist with an idea for a cover design, a graphic designer's worst nightmare. But in fact, every cover has had a lot of input for me. The triangle cover, you're looking at a shirtwaist I bought on eBay.
Oh, wow. How fun. You know, I love that. That's, by the way, my favorite novel, just so you know.
Thank you. The Balthus painting on the Little Women, in the very last scene of the book, the three sisters virtually take the pose of that painting. They become the three sisters in the painting on the final page. You know, so the covers have a relationship, and in fact, objects, avalanche. Well, that's you California people with your earthquake.
That's just me, no earthquake. That's just me.
Right. But I'm a huge believer in the people do judge a book by its cover. There's no question. And I want to say The Postmistress of Paris has a marvelous cover. I love the balance, the symmetry and the asymmetry, and the figure in relation to the Eiffel Tower. And there's just something marvelous and inviting, including the sort of the open doors looking out into foggy Paris, where it just invites you, you know, to open the book and start reading. And it's really a marvelous cover.
Thank you. You know, I published with HarperCollins, Harper Books, and they have been really just lovely about consulting me on the cover. We started with a cover in that I had some concerns with, and we kept trying to fix those concerns, and it just kept getting worse and worse. And then finally we said, okay, we're just gonna start over. And right. Then that's when we went back to Joe O'Neill, who's the cover artist, and that was almost, you know, the new start with very few tweaks. And we're like, oh yeah, that's it, thank you. Yeah. So
There it is.
Yeah. It's interesting, good. Have you ever had a cover that you don't like? It sounds like you've had enough input into your covers that you—
I haven't loved every cover of foreign editions. I haven't loved every paperback cover. The cover I liked least of all was a Dutch edition of The Music Lesson where they spelled my name wrong. Just saying.
These things happen and you just roll with it, right?
Right. But I feel that it's an integral part of the experience of reading one of my books anyway. And I know, I mean, I grew up with books with no jackets because the jackets had gotten lost and just those buckram bindings on the bookshelf. So I realized that a lot of cover art, you know, would surprise you if you've only ever held, you know, the naked book with the buckram binding. But it feels to me that it's an essential part of putting the book into the world.
Yeah, I totally agree. Well, we've got just a few more minutes here. So if anybody wants to ask a question, do please throw them in. I am in the meantime going to ask about the revision process of this. If, you know, as you went back and revisited these stories, many of which, are they all previously published or?
Well, almost all, but in such altered forms, you know, it would be like, you know, you went to McDonald's once for lunch. That doesn't mean you've eaten in fine restaurants in Paris. Some very, you know, very basic stories that fulfilled, in some cases, you know, there's one story here that's vastly expanded that began as a cute meet for Red Book, the people who meet on jury duty, but it has become very expanded and has all kinds of layers of meaning and texture, you know, that certainly were not there before. It isn't just retread. It isn't just recycling by any means. It's really just re-engaging. You know, you accept it in a museum when you see a painting and it says the dates are 1917 to 1922, which means the painter came back to it and maybe was painting it every moment or maybe put it down for several years and came back to it. But we accept that. And
I totally, and a lot of the, and they're very fresh. I mean, the changes are really fresh. And what I was going to ask is did you think about putting the collection together and then start looking at the stories and decide, oh, I want to do this differently, you want to do that differently? Or did you start with kind of revising, you know, revisiting some stories and thinking you might want to do them differently and then ending up with a collection?
It's a good question. The intention was a collection with the novella. I began writing the novella and then also revising the stories. So I was sort of working from front to back and then writing the novella at the same time, which is certainly another way for echoes to be there. You know, yeah, I love echoes. I love word echoes, image echoes, echoes of moments. You know, the flapping blue tarp that's at the top of the World Trade Center is one of those blue tarps. You can picture it in your mind's eye with the metal grommets that people fasten over a boat in their driveway. It's the blue tarp that's obscuring the entrance to the bomb shelter. You know, I mean, the things are all around us, and you might have some of the same objects in your house that I have in my house, but they have different meaning for you and they come from somewhere different. And there's something really fascinating to me about the way we have objects that are sort of mute witnesses to our lives, and we add meaning to them, and then they lose meaning. That was part of what I was doing, which sounds a little bit like a crazy person.
Not at all.
But one of the definitions of psychosis is when you add meaning to reality, and it's everything has more meaning than other people don't notice, you know.
But I do think, you know, when you're talking about echoes, I mean, I also love echoes. And what I like about them is that, you know, you have something that appears on page one, and it, you know, when it appears there, it picks up a little bit of emotion with it in some way. And then when it reappears in a little different form or whatever, it picks up a different or more or deeper meaning.
Absolutely.
And so that by the time you get to the end, that thing that you've echoed, you know, I like to think of it as like, you know, it starts out and it's just a violin playing, and then later on in the book and it's an oboe playing, and then by the time you get to the end, it's all those things playing together. And so I think it's just a brilliant way to, I think it is the single most effective way to carry emotion through a story by attaching it to, you know, physical things basically, and then echoing them. So I think the way you did that was beautiful.
And I do make a comparison to music. I do think it's that echo that, which is why I think reading it, I don't mean in one fell swoop literally, but I think if you read the stories in sequence all the way through to the novella and read the novella, there are those echoes that you wouldn't catch if you read one story a month, unless you have an amazing memory. And it is constructed that way. I see a question from Corey Campbell.
Yeah, I have a couple. I was just going to say, let's jump to the question. So Allison asked, do you have any stories you wish you could have included in this book that you didn't get to?
No. No. Okay. There were things I was going to include, and then I realized, no, it's just not good enough, and I'd have nothing more to add to it, and it's just, no, it needs to stay behind.
Okay. Corey Campbell asks, Jane, she wasn't entirely certain that other people were as alive as she was. Sometimes there's a quote. Sometimes I wonder what you're thinking when you write something like this from an altogether beautiful passage. And I totally agree with that. And go ahead. Sometimes I wonder what you're thinking when you write something like this is the question.
I'm thinking of my way into Jane as she exists, Jane as she thinks and feels. It's maybe it's the Stanislavski method of writing, you know, but it's like inhabiting the character. It sounds really pretentious to say it's a thespian choice, but it is really an impersonation. Sounds artificial in some way. It's really just dwelling with the character and you know, allowing myself to give her the words for her thoughts and how she, you know, perceives. And I want her to have that child's certainty and uncertainty, that balancing act, that high wire act that is childhood of certainties and uncertainties. And you think you know things, but you think you don't know anything. And that awareness of her own consciousness and not being convinced that other people were as alive as she is, which is a massively egotistical thing to say if you're 45, but if you're a child, it's part of beginning to understand that other people have inner lives. You know, I mean, I think the psychological term is to mentalize, to understand that other people dwell inside themselves the way you dwell inside yourself. And I think that is part of growing up, and you gain things, you lose things. And I think it's a really interesting age when you're just sort of right there at the hinge.
Great. I have one more question. We're going to get to that and then going to wrap it up. But before we get to that, that what you just said made me think of something I would like to ask, which is, are there any characters in this collection that, I mean, sometimes it's really hard to get into a character that's very different than you are. Is there any character here in these stories who was particularly hard for you to write? And could you talk about how you met that challenge, if there was?
I think I took crazy risks with the story about Zaplinsky on Madagascar. I mean, that's so out of my experience. And you know, yes, there's do research. I mean, I'm not at all interested in write what you know, but I'm very, very interested in know what you write. So if you're setting something on Madagascar, you know, there aren't going to be igloos. You know, you need to know what the spiders look like, you know. So I think it was just an alien territory. Start to finish, everything, you know, the what happens in Budapest, you know, as the Third Reich takes over. I mean, so it was a kind of crazy history that then the narrator maybe is making up and owns that there are gaps and it couldn't possibly be that way. And in that sense, it's got a relationship to Jane of Hearts, where it owns its own uncertainties by the end. You know, yeah. Maybe it happened, maybe it didn't. I'm telling you it happened. Let's just say it happened.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Let's just say, right. I've got two other quick things. One is just a comment. Jessica Ainsworth says, enjoying listening to this so much as there's so much information on writing. Already looked up the New Yorker story and we'll read it when this is over. No questions, but thank you. Great program. And then, thank you so much, Jessica. And then Victoria Zechheim, who we both know from our days, right? Asks, what's next as far as writing projects?
Well, I'd love to know what you're writing next.
I never know.
Okay. Well, I'm writing a novel that has an Amish element after spending those years in Central Ohio at Kenyon College, which is surrounded by Amish farms and Amish people who fascinated me. I would follow them in the Kroger to see what they were buying. And I was very surprised to see an old order Amish lady with a cart full of Pringles, I have to say. really fascinated me. But there's an Amish element to the story that I'm writing now.
That kind of contrast, you know, the unexpected is so, you know, that Amish woman buying Pringles.
With her Pringles,
that
yes.
kind of thing that makes a character just pop to life and makes us want to know about them. And it's the, you know, one of the many things that you do so brilliantly in this collection of Jane of Hearts. I'm going to make one last pitch for everybody, which is that one, buy it. It's wonderful. You will thoroughly enjoy it. And do please support Book Passage, who has been so kind to host us here. I'll tell you that my personal belief is that if it weren't for stores like Book Passage, we would lose the vibrancy of our literature, because it's almost all new authors find their first audiences at their own local bookstores. So please consider.
Book Passage is for readers. Book Passage is for writers. It's, you know, it's the indie bookstores that really hold our culture. And I mean that. I mean, fine, buy your underwear on Amazon if you want to, but really.
Again, Jane of Hearts, look for it. Gorgeous cover. I'm sure they have copies at Book Passage, and you can probably get them anywhere in the world from Book Passage. I'm sure they ship. So here we go. Katharine, congratulations again. I just absolutely love this collection, and I'm so delighted to have gotten to chat with you about it.
Meg, thank you so much. I just so appreciate your enthusiasm and insight and energy and generosity. And as I said at the beginning, there's something different about a conversation about a book. First of all, we end up talking about writing in a different way. But from, you know, writers I admire, when, you know, it's not just a mutual admiration festival. It's real. It's a real engagement that has a very different quality. And I think it's something that readers actually do find chewy, interesting.
Yeah.
But I really appreciate your just being so engaged with it. And it means a lot to me, because I think you're such a terrific writer, and I am thrilled for your success.
Thank you. Well, on that generosity thing, I'm going to say again that you blurred my first novel for no reason other than that you're a generous person. And it was good.
I would not have blurbed it.
But I truly try to pay that generosity forward every day of my writing life by blurbing other people, by, you know, whatever. But I'm so delighted to get to repay it in this very small way, which is all my pleasure, which is getting to chat with you about this beautiful new collection.
I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, alrighty then, everybody. Thank you for everybody that came out, and thank you for all the kind things that you said about the bookstore as well. I think maybe we'll use that for our next catch line. Say you can purchase whatever you want elsewhere on the internet, but for all your book needs, come to
Buy
Book
your
Passage.
books. Yes.
And you know what? She's absolutely correct. You can absolutely we will ship any number of books to you, particularly in the United States. And if you are international, we can always work something out for you. You can give us a call over at the store. We do that quite frequently. And additionally, I should mention that if you'd like to purchase any of Meg's books, then you should also come over to Book Passage as well. As I said earlier, The Postmistress of Paris was quite an excellent book. And I'm certain if the rest of her books are even half as good, they're still worth reading. And I imagine they're more than half as good. lastly, one more thing for the audience at home. The wonderful, wonderful thing about watching this on YouTube is if you came in halfway through the show and you're like, I wish I could have seen this. Well, look, you can. Right here, there's a little red bar at the bottom of the screen. You can just click the little timer thing that you have and just drag it all the way back to the beginning. You can watch it all the way to the beginning of the smooth bookstore jazz, or you can skip even my introduction and go directly into the show. You can do that anytime, including after we finish what's here. The recording is going to go up, and it'll be right here on this page. So don't even worry about it. It's going to be great.
And if we bore you, you could just skip ahead, too.
That's true.
But, We don't bore. Not a boring second in this one.
Thank you to everybody that was also writing wonderful comments in the chat. I didn't copy all of them over for our speakers to see, but I rest assured I will share them afterwards. So anyways, thank you one last time tonight, everybody. It was really lovely, and I do hope to see you all in the next one. Bye.
Thank you, Book Passage. Bye. Thank you.